to yet another edition of Time Pass for the New Indian Express. I have with me the lovely Chunky Pandey, who is always smiling and always very pleasant. We've seen him from Akhe to Akhri Pasta, the Indo-Italian in-house school, which is really sort of, recreated and reinvented you, Chunky. So thank you for joining us. And how does it feel to make your digital debut at the pretty ripe old age, right?
yeah, absolutely. My beard is so ripe right now.
Yes. And you're not playing a very nice man, right? In Abhay 2?
Oh, you don't want to meet this man ever. Because he's going to eat you up if he meets you.
literally, I believe. So, how has it been to make that transition from the good guy to the really evil guy in a really long and eventful career?
You know, when I started off with all these multi-starers and playing the hero and sometimes the second hero in the films. And they were normally very one-dimensional characters because they were good guys. You know, they wooed the heroines and they did all the nice things for society. Mm. But then came a little darker shades of me, like the character like Babban, which I played in Tezab.
Yeah.
Again, there was a character I played in Vishwatma.
Yeah.
Again, he was a conventional hero, but he had a little darker element to him. But then finally, when I came down doing these characters and I started getting like films like Apna Sapna Mani Mani, where I played like a Nepali don.
Yeah.
So I actually put a very comic element to that character who was a dark character.
Right.
And then Akhri Pasta, which is somewhere my alter ego, you know. The guy who wants to say everything and just say, I'm joking.
Yeah.
Try to get away with it.
Right.
But playing these characters have been, especially this character has been very interesting because this is genuinely a three-dimensional character. He's got so many, not only layers, but he's got so many faces. He's really Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Mm.
He's this very sweet uncle in the day who runs a beautiful Xerox copying shop, you know, and sells stationery. He's a loving husband to his wife.
Right.
But he's got this element which is so disturbing that that's what really scares you, that you can really think that maybe this man lives next door and maybe we have a killer living next door. So.
Right.
Yeah, that's what, and this is actually based on a real true life story. So, yeah.
Scary.
Yeah, scary.
So, Abhay 2 is a streaming season that has returned for a streaming series that has returned for the second season. And
yes.
You're the antagonist to Kunal Kemu's protagonist. And you've changed your physicality as well, Chunky.
Okay, so I've always had this whitish hair, so I didn't need to use anything on that. But I changed my walk completely. I introduced a paunch on my stomach, like a big stomach, and I put in a little limp in my walk, a slouch in my stance,
right?
And just the way he speaks and the glasses which he wears, I actually picked it up from an old school teacher of mine. He was a very beautiful, lovely teacher, and a very kind teacher and a very soft-spoken teacher, but he had a horrible temper. And when he lost his temper, it was so scary. And in those days, it was very normal to hit kids with canes and rulers and stuff. So he used to paste the shit out of us. So I, as a kid, I remember I was very, very young. I used to think, man, this guy must be a real killer at home. You know, he must be going home and murdering kids. So, you know, when this role got offered to me, I tried to, you know, design it around what that man looked like and the way he spoke. So you'll find this very beautiful person, but he's very disturbing.
So, Chunky, even after so many years, what makes you excited about getting into a role? Is there a sense of excitement, a sense of anticipation? I'm doing something new. How many movies have you done? Over 80?
Yeah, I've done about 80 films and I've done like a few TV shows where I've been a judge and stuff like that. And then this is my first outing with the OTT platform. But now suddenly there have been a lot of offers coming in on the OTT platform. And I'm very excited because it's a great platform. You can experiment a lot. There's no censorship, so that makes things even easier.
Right.
But you can really play around with a lot of creativity on this. You know, there's no thing of box office pressure and stuff. So I'm actually enjoying this.
Right.
And a character like this, when you get, then I guess it makes it even more interesting.
Right.
I I have been experimenting with darker roles. Like 3 years ago, I did a film called Begum Jaan with Vidya Balan.
Vidya Balan, of course.
Then last year was a good year for me because I had 4 releases last year.
Yeah.
I had Saho with Prabhas.
Yeah, you were the villain there.
Yes. Yes. And then I had my Houseful, my favorite.
Of course.
Houseful 4. Then I had a film with Sanjay Dutt called Prasthanam.
Yes.
And again, I played a darkish character. And then I had Jawani Janeman with Saif Ali Khan.
Yes.
So, 2019 and early 20s was very exciting for me, yes.
So, Chunky, it's very interesting to see someone like you who's actually the son of 2 doctors and 1 very well-known cardiac surgeon. I believe he's quite an institution. There's a road named after him as well, right?
Yeah, it's like a chalk named after my dad.
Yeah.
And he's no more with us, but, I must confess, he was always my role model and I really wanted to be a doctor. Really, really. Because as a kid, I was told, all my relatives and family friends that, oh, tu to bade banke doctor hi banega, just like your dad.
Right.
And I must confess, I really, really tried. I tried very hard. In fact, I got a degree called MBBF.
What? Looks then, like...
Metric mein bar bar fail.
I knew it was something like that. But what happened? You were not good in. You were not good academically.
No, I was good, but maybe I just couldn't concentrate, and maybe I just didn't have the aptitude, or maybe I was just not cut out to be so.
Right.
And they say, sometimes a profession skips a generation.
Yeah.
When I had my girls, and especially Ananya, I thought maybe Ananya will become a doctor because she was really good in studies, and she's like got a photographic memory with things. So she's, I can call her intelligent. But she chose to join movies.
So there's nothing you can do. That's something that obviously is in the Pandey blood now. But
yes.
Was your father around when you began in movies? What did he think of it?
Yes, he was very, very, very excited. And in fact, he told me that, when I came home and told them one fine day I'd returned from the U.S. I'd won a free ticket to the U.S. And when I returned home...
For what? What did you win a free ticket for?
A free ticket to go to the U.S.
For what? How?
Yeah, so what had happened was there was someone who needed some help with a show happening.
Okay.
And it was a Kishore Kumar show.
Okay.
And I helped that person and that person gave me a free ticket to go as a groupie on the show. Like a helper on the show.
Right.
So when I went on that show and I traveled with Mr. Kishore Kumar and I remember there was Amol Palekar on that show and there were a few people on that show, I realized, being an actor or a singer had so many advantages. You were loved by so many people and you got to travel the world. And I was just about 21, and I was trying a lot of other things in my life. I finished my graduation and I was trying different businesses and things. They were not really working. And then I said, man, this is not a bad profession. And then I was in LA. My cousin lived in LA and I'd gone to pick him up. He used to work in an acting school, my cousin. And I went to pick him up and his class was not over. So I was waiting for him to come out. And this lady comes up and tells me, she spoke to me in Spanish. I couldn't understand that. So I said, no, I speak English. So she says, are you in the entertainment? Are you in the movie business? Are you an actor? So I said, no, but why? So she gave me a card and she was actually a casting director. And she says, if you ever change your mind, call me.
Oh.
So I had no idea of getting into movies, but getting that card and, it right. But then I knew Hollywood is a very difficult place. Let me come back to my own country and at least try here. So I came home and I told my parents, listen, mom and dad, don't get too shocked, but I really want to enter movies. And I thought they'll get really angry. But my dad said, well, if you want to do that, then you have to train to get into movies.
Right.
You've done your college, but that's not enough.
Right.
So I started training in acting and, horse riding and different things, whatever I could do. And then I would go and audition for movies.
Right.
I started modeling to make some money. And yeah, it was a process. It was a journey. And then I auditioned for a lot of television shows. I remember Mahabharat was being made. I auditioned for that. I launched it there.
For which role?
So Arjun's role I had auditioned for.
Interesting.
And then I had auditioned for Hyber Films.
Okay.
And I remember I didn't get that. Then I remember I had auditioned for something for N. Chandra, for Pratigar. That was just before Tezab, what he made. And I remember that time he told me, he says, you know, you're not suited for this role because this is a role of an inspector.
Yeah.
But I'm going to make something very big, very soon, and I'm going to think of you then.
Yeah.
So that's when Tezab came a few years later. And then I actually met the producer of my first film in the toilet of a five-star hotel.
And no less than Pehlaj Nehlani.
Can you believe it? Can you believe it? So, you know, there I was wearing a churidar kurta and I couldn't open my nada of the churidar because I really
Too much information, Chunky.
I was shouting and screaming, someone help me in the toilet, in the men's toilet. And then suddenly he decided to help me. And we got into this conversation. And, you know, in that time there was no internet. So I didn't know what he looked like. But I'd heard his name because he had just given Govinda the best launch possible in Ilzaam.
Yeah.
And then in the conversation in the bathroom, you know, he said, you know, I'm looking for a new boy. What do you do? I said, I model. He says, come and meet me tomorrow. And that's how my career started. It started from a toilet of a hotel. Yeah.
With your pajama not opening. My God, no. I've not heard this detail. But Chunky, you're also a very interesting storyteller. And you also seem everybody's best friend. You seem to be at every party and you're always smiling. I mean, how does it work? How do you manage to be everywhere and never seem to lose your cool, and everybody seems to love you? So what is the secret?
I think I'm a very content person, and I instead of running the race, sometimes I like to become a spectator and watch.
Hmm.
So, you know, sometimes I like to be in the race, but most of the times I like to watch it as a spectator, including my own career and my own profession.
Hmm.
So I take that back seat very, very often. And I think only experience has taught me that. Because, you know, if you're constantly trying to crunch numbers and, you know, trying to place yourself and trying to find your footing in the number game, then I guess somewhere, you know, you get to, I think it can affect you. But I'm very happy I'm doing characters. I'm getting great characters. This is the golden moment of my life. I know a film is not dependent on me. It doesn't sell because of me.
So there's no pressure.
There's no pressure. And touch wood, you know, the audience has also loved me and given me a lot of second and third chances. So, I'm very grateful for where I am. And I guess it's just all about keeping your mind happy. That's it.
But, Chunky, we have to talk about this whole idea of insider versus outsider, because that's the biggest debate right now. And sometimes, Ananya, your daughter gets a lot of flack, online especially. I wonder, as a father, does that hurt you? Because it must, I'm sure. You know, you must be feeling hurt for your child as well. And yet, you know, people are coming from a place of hurt as well, those who are attacking her. So how do you feel about all that?
You know, it's, as a father, I get very appalled to see kids being attacked.
Yeah.
Young children, you know, it's like they shouldn't, I mean, okay, they have chosen to be on the social media platform, but a lot of them get attacked. And I've seen a lot of girls get attacked more than guys.
Yeah, you know, and in very nasty and vicious
ways. Yeah, in very nasty and vicious ways. So I feel for all the kids that get attacked. But then, you know, you have chosen to be on that platform. And every platform does come with some plus points and some minus points. Look at the plus points today. I mean, it gives you instant fame. You connect with your audience. It's the best thing. But you have to learn to use it as a tool. It can't become your personality. Mm. I mean, you have to treat it like you would treat your phone. Mm. You know? So you can't get emotional and you can't let that get you. That's the only advice I can give my daughter. As for her, you know, her journey, she knows exactly how she got her first film. Mm. And when it comes to insiders and outsiders, I feel the moment you sign your first film, you become an insider. Mm. You're no longer an outsider.
Right.
So, outsider is a person who's trying to get into the film industry.
Right.
But the moment you sign it, you're in the game, you're in the process, and everyone has a different journey. Believe me, you cannot compare two careers ever. Because, you know, there's a lot of hits and misses in careers. You know, you come in, you arrive, you get busy, someone else gets your roles. Or then someone else gets very busy and you get their roles. not necessarily that one director has made a hit film, you work with him, he's going to make a hit film with you. No. And sometimes you work with a director who's given three flops and suddenly gives the biggest hit of his life with you. So there's a lot of permutation combination. And if someone tells you that they know that magic formula of successful films, no one knows. We're just trying to tell stories, working hard, and I hope hoping that the audience really enjoys it. So I don't see anything like an insider or outsider. I've been around for 33 years. And everyone who is in the industry, who's arrived and been accepted, is always like your companion, your co-worker, you know, so comrade, whatever you call it. So I've never seen that difference.
But Chunky, why is there currently, you've been in the industry now for so long and you've observed it for even longer, like all of us who, you know, some of us are not part of it, we've observed it. What is the tipping point right now? What happened with Sushant Singh's death that seems to have turned everything topsy-turvy, or at least it seems to people outside?
No, we cannot blame it on anyone's death. It's actually the coronavirus. It's been so lethal on everyone's minds. Even if you've not been affected by it personally, if you've not had the virus, but the virus has, you know, because of the lockdowns and people being locked up at home and, you know, not working and money shortage and so many things, I think it has mentally affected everyone. I mean, I have been affected. I mean, today I am 57. I consider myself experienced. Touch wood, I'm slightly well settled in life, but I am feeling that anxiety. So I'm sure the whole world is feeling that anxiety. And when you have anxiety like this, it can lead to a lot of things that is not your personality. So that's why you're seeing more of it right now. Yes, of course, that was discussed a lot, and it was a never-ending discussion and a debate. But being a part of the industry, I can tell you that there is no real truth to it. I mean, we've had people from all spheres of life joining as actors, as cinematographers, as choreographers. Everyone it's a family. The film industry lives like a family. And anyone you ask will vouch for it. There's no doubt about it. You catch anyone. Of course, people do have their grievances. It's normal to have grievances. I used to have so many grievances. But you have to learn to... I mean, like, I remember the first time I was nominated for the Filmfare Awards. This was way back in 88, 89. I was nominated for Tezab.
Tezab is Best Supporting Actor, right?
Yes. And I was shooting in Goa, I remember, with Sanjay Dutt for Do Marwale. And, you know, I really wanted to leave the shooting and fly back to go and get my award because I was so confident I was going to win it. Mm. And I begged the producer and he said, you know, I'll lose a lot of money for it. I told Sanju, just do something. I have to go. So he also made up a story and they let me go for that evening. I flew from Goa to Bombay and I remember I was at the Centro Hotel and I was so confident on winning that award that when the nominations were announced and the winner is, I actually got up and started walking towards the stage. And then they actually gave it to Anupam Kher for a film called Vijay.
Right.
And I never stopped walking. I actually walked to the toilet and then I left the venue. So, you know, as a young, I was only 23 years old then. So it did disturb me. It did. But then it was all my fault.
Yeah.
If I go to think of it, I thought I'd won the award. So it's not fair. I mean, you can have any opinion. You may not be the most deserving thing for it. So these are things you have to learn to live with. And there are things, you know, that do this thing. But I feel things like these tragedies do happen in everyone's life and you just have to move on. You just have to... I tell my daughter that. I keep telling her, do not try to imitate anyone else's success. Just do your own story, your own journey, and you'll be the happiest because then you'll stop comparing and you'll just go through life happy and smiling. And she's got a very positive, happy mindset.
She doesn't get bogged down by some of the things that are said about her or around her?
I'm sure she does. I'm sure. She's human. Of course she does. But she has to learn to live with it and deal with it. And I'm sure it has disturbed her in many ways. But she's a strong girl and I'm sure she will. And she's also got this initiative called So Positive where, you know, she helps people who are getting constantly bullied on the internet. So she's a strong girl, that's what. And well, I hope it stops soon. But then there'll always be something new. So you have to be prepared for it.
Chunky, you know, one of the things that has come out of this whole debate has been this whole idea of networking, being seen at the right places, being seen with the right people. How important is that in the industry? How important is all that?
So see, I mean, right from my times, there were things called camps. But yeah. What is camps? Let me explain to you what is camps.
What are camps and what are cliques? Let's understand that.
Tell me something. You have a carpenter coming to your house.
Yeah.
Or a worker coming to your house. I'm sure you call the same carpenter all the time. No?
Yeah.
But there are 100 other carpenters in Bombay, right?
Exactly.
Why do you call that carpenter? Because you're comfortable with that carpenter.
Right.
That is what is favoritism, is nothing but you're comfortable working with someone. And Hollywood does it all the time. You see Coen Brother films. They have used the same actors all the time. So many actors, so many big directors like to work with the same actors because they're comfortable working with them.
Scorsese and DiCaprio, for instance, they work with each other.
They keep working with each other. So it's very common. I mean, in real life, we use favoritism for anything. We have... There are 10 grocery shops up down my road, but I only go to one. So this is how human beings are made. Now talking about cliques and this thing, everyone, friends are friends, you know, like when you're doing a movie together, everyone is like a family. The moment the film gets over, you'll all get separated. So I don't believe in this. It doesn't work that way. Of course, what really works is sellability. You have to be sellable to work. But barring that, it's just because you're comfortable with someone, that's why you're repeating that person. Mm. And believe me, this is the truth. I don't see anything else.
Mm. Chunky, how has storytelling changed from when you began? How do you see that having changed? The characters, the plots, the dialects. You hear so much more diversity than perhaps when you began. Or is that so?
I think now less has become more. Yeah. So a lot of the young actors, they underplay a lot of their performances. Yeah. But I am like from the old school. I like the loud acting and, you know,
right.
Stuff. But cinema is all about entertainment. It's all about that going to the theater, laughing with everyone, crying with everyone, clapping with everyone, whistling with everyone. We make films for that. Now, sometimes it does, those films do not get cinema theater releases and they come on the OTT platform. But there are certain films that are meant only to be enjoyed on the screen. They won't have that kind of effect on a small television set. Of course, cinema has changed in a big way. The game has become bigger. I think today is the golden period of entertainment. Especially if for someone trying to break into the entertainment industry, it's never been better. Because you have your social media platforms. You have the OTT platforms which are welcoming new faces and taking even older talent that have been out of work today. They've all got work and there's such hidden gems being discovered on the OTT platform.
Right.
So I think it's the best time to be in the entertainment business. And I think in the next 6 months to a year, it's going to be booming even more. But my advice to people is, if you want to get into the entertainment business, you have to be where it's happening. You cannot be sitting in some corner of India and commenting and saying like, you know, you need to be in Bombay. You need to be in the business. You know, you need to go and audition. Today they're casting directors for everything. There's modeling happening.
Yeah.
So you need to really go out there and do it. You cannot sit somewhere and comment about it.
Right.
You have to come here and do it. Yeah.
And you have to be persistent. Nothing is easy.
No, nothing. You have to be persistent and you have to be accepted. People should love what you're doing.
Right.
People are today, you have such big TikTok stars. People are loving what they're doing on TikTok and Instagram. And even I watch it and I get so amused. And these are all self-made guys, you know. They've created their own videos. So India's got so much talent. And it's all waiting to explode. And I think it's the most beautiful time. Yeah.
Chunky, when you see the way you're portrayed in the media, are you happy with that? Sometimes it's, you know, very affable guy. But also, you know, little like Aakri Pasta.
So sometimes people call me miser and, you know, there's so many other things they put on to me.
Why
so
is that?
I don't know. I mean, maybe someone gave me that kind of reputation. But I must tell you this, which very few people know, like back in the 80s and 90s, I had the biggest parties in Bollywood.
Oh. Really?
My birthday would be the biggest day of the year, and my New Year parties used to be the biggest ever.
Oh, okay.
But like, you know, where I had like 400-500 people attending them, and I did this
home or at other people?
No, no, at my bungalow, and then I used to have parties at Sun and Sand. So I've always been a person who's liked to entertain people and, you know, and enjoy the good life and celebrate life. Actually, life should be all about celebration and good times. So, but I do have this reputation sometimes. I don't know who's really put it in. And then people take me very lightly, but I don't mind that. No. I don't want people to take me too seriously. I don't want too many people depending on me.
Right.
It's too much pressure.
Do you take yourself seriously?
I'm a joke. Obviously, no. I don't. I'm still a little child somewhere, you know. My wife also says that. And I think that's what really keeps me going. I get happy with the smallest of things, and they just amuse me. And many times, you'll find me laughing in a corner by myself because I just find things amusing. And I think that's the only way to keep yourself young and keep yourself going and keep yourself creative.
Yeah. We're talking about Sun and Sand. Those really were the days, no? I mean, Sun and Sand itself no longer exists as far as I know, right?
No, it's there. Why are you...
Still there? It's there. But yeah, it's still it used there. To be a big hub earlier for Bollywood. It's
It was
it's not that kind of place, no?
Yeah, it's not a hub anymore, but yeah, the bar used to have the topmost actors and the topmost producers, directors, financiers, distributors.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you were a newcomer there, if you hung around Sun and Sand, you would get noticed.
Right. Yeah, so I guess the equivalent of what Prithvi Theatre would be now. So,
yes.
So how that has been a huge change, no? That people would just throw parties for like no reason at all or whatever. Now everything's far more organized and tailored to certain things, celebrated.
I mean, Bollywood still has the big parties. I mean, you have the big Diwali parties happening.
They're only at Mannat, I thought, and maybe. Mm-hmm.
Amitji has the best Diwali parties, right. And he has the whole industry there. And then there are a lot of parties. People, everyone entertains. I mean, as I said, it's all about celebrations.
Hmm.
And, but yes, they've gone down. I mean, there used to be a lot more parties. But now I guess people have become, you know, they have smaller house parties.
Hmm.
And, but everyone finds out about them because of the Instagram. Everyone's posting pictures and, you know, everything that happens in every party. That's why I'm telling you, things have become so beautiful. You can actually disclose to the world what you want them to see.
Right.
You know, it's all in your control now.
Right. But, you know, Chunky, the whole idea of these blind items that are written, and there's been a lot of criticism of the media for this kind of journalism. Do you think it affects people? It really can make psychologically damage the people it's written about?
The blind items?
Yeah.
You're seeing what's happening in the news channels, right?
Exactly. Those are not blind. Those are like colorblind. Do you watch the news, Chunky? I do. I watch it.
I shouldn't be laughing, but
because it can be quite serious.
Yeah, it's very serious what I'm talking, but it's, you know, journalism has always been criticized. Whether, you know, it's been the older magazines what we used to have in our times, like the magazines like Stardust and Cineblitz. And
but there was an element of fun in that. The Garam Garam and Zini Baby. And you know, those epithets were fun.
Yeah, yeah. But they were always criticized. Especially by the industry. Like, yeah, kya likh diya? You know, they caught someone having an affair or something.
Yeah.
But you know, in those days, we all knew the editors so well. And we would try to control things.
Right.
But they always never really happened. So it's, you know, really nothing much has changed. This journalism has been around for a long time. It's just now that they're being called blind items and all. Mm-hmm. And blind item is better than having your name being shouted.
That is true.
Yeah, in the old days, they take your name straight. Now they are scared of getting litigation and people have become more law by, you know, conscious of the law. So they're making them into blind items. But, you know, film journalism has always been like that. And it's been entertaining. I mean, people want to read. We are there for that, you know, we are there for that larger than life kind of you know, the filmy stories with the good, the bad, and the ugly, and everything happening. So this is what showbiz is about. We shouldn't forget that. Otherwise, it would be boring.
Were you ever called anything interesting by the stardusts of the world? Everyone had a nickname, I think.
Yeah, but I used to love those magazines. I used to wait for them to come, and I was always ready to shoot for them. And it was like, like once I remember an actor told me that a good photograph can get you as many fans as a good film.
Okay.
So like a good photograph in a magazine.
Right.
Can actually win you over fans.
Right.
I always remembered that. So I used to take a lot of interest in my photo shoots and do some, you know, stuff like that. And today it's the same. Today you see these Instagram stars.
Yeah,
you know, they have those great pictures and they've got fans because of those photographs.
Right.
So yeah, that's things have not changed. They're just being repackaged in different ways.
Hmm.
So you can't blame the blind items or today what is happening on television, because that's what showbiz is all about.
Hmm.
And showbiz sells. I mean, it's very fact that it's going on and on and on. Comes to know that this is what is working and selling in the country.
And it's come to the front page. It used to be, at the back page. Now it's front page news everywhere.
I know, and I've never seen Bollywood in the news for so long. I mean, it's been two months now. It's been every day on every channel. But it's a sad thing. I mean, his death has been obviously a very big loss to the film industry. And he's a boy I was very fond of. I'd worked with him. I'd done a couple of. I have an events company, and this is before he became the film actor Sushant when he was on television. I'd used him and Ankita in a couple of shows. We'd done Bangalore, South Africa. We'd done Bangladesh. Very, very sweet kid. And I remember, I mean, when I went and saw his first film, Kaipoche, I went for the premiere, and I met him after that, and I thought he was brilliant. I told him, you know, boy, you've arrived on the platform. Hey, he was a superstar right from the word go. And then I remember Ananya had booked tickets for Dhoni first day last show.
Hmm.
And we'd gone to PVR Zoo to see it. And both of us were blown away after Dhoni.
Hmm.
He did that biopic, MS Dhoni's character, so well and so convincing. Later on, I saw him in Kedarnath and then lastly in Chichore. And the boy was a brilliant actor. Went too soon. I mean, there are so many reasons being put behind his death. So let I guess once everything is clear, but it's a great loss here. And I think he was cherished. He was one of the, I mean, he was in the top 10 actors of Bollywood and doing really, really so well. So I would just say a life gone, snuffed out too early. And we don't know the reason. I mean, it's sad. I mean, really good. I mean, he was a great, good actor. Yeah.
Chunky, you talked briefly about Bangladesh. It reminded me. You had a very interesting stint in Bangladesh as a hero. How did that happen?
Oh, God. So, yeah. So, 93, after Aakhi, I was not really getting the offers I really wanted.
Right.
It was a huge blockbuster. So, I only had one film after that, NNCP's Teesra Phone. And then suddenly I was, you know, getting Hero Ke Bhai ka role and this ka role, and I was not excited. You know, I had done better work. So I decided to take a little sabbatical. I opened an events company. I went around the world doing a lot of shows. I went to Africa, I went to Europe, I went to South America. Everywhere there was the Indian diaspora, the Asian diaspora. I went and did shows. I went to Korea, Japan, so many countries.
With other actors and yourself, or with...
Yeah, with other actors, yeah, with other actors. And then I went for a show to Bangladesh. And then I got offered this movie in Bangladesh.
Okay.
And I kind of really liked that. It was a multi-starrer again. And that film turned out to be a blockbuster. And then I got another film and another film. And then my films would release on Eid. And it was like a big occasion. And the films did well. And I was really excited the way things were going. Till 98, I got married. And then I actually took my wife there, not on a honeymoon, just after a honeymoon. And She loved the food there because Bangladesh food is brilliant. But she told me, she says, Chunky, you're having a great run here. But it's time you came back because you are known because of Bollywood. And how can you take such a long break for me? And I'd been away now almost 7-8 years. So I finally, in 2000, I came back and I went again to producers' offices. Like I started in 1986, 87.
You had to go back again.
Yeah, back again asking for work. And... there's no shame asking for
it. Yeah. Mr. Bhatt did it with Yash Chopra.
Sorry?
Mr. Bachchan did it with Yash Chopra for Mohabbate.
So I've heard that, yeah. So I went and I him doing it is such a great thing. Yeah. I mean, and it paid off, I mean.
Exactly.
Yeah, he never looked back after that. So, and I was lucky I got a few roles. And I did, I kind of decided by then that now I'm going to be doing characters.
Right.
And I knew there was a huge section of the audience that had forgotten me. Like a generation literally that had forgotten me. I had to kind of win them back, especially the younger kids. So I decided on concentrating on comic roles, and they came my way. And I was very lucky the audience accepted me back. Yeah, that was very important. So yeah. And it's been a good run. I have no complaints. I've enjoyed myself since I've been back.
And in a way, this is your maybe fourth run, which could be the digital version of Chunky Pandey. That might also yield some interesting results.
Oh, you mean this platform of the OTT?
Yes.
Oh, you're going to see a lot of my faces on this OTT. Yeah. Because I'm in negotiation with two other shows right now.
Yeah.
Besides Abhay, which I've just finished. And those are, again, very, very, very diverse characters. Characters you've not seen before on the screen. So I'm excited. I'm really enjoying this period. Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see you competing with your daughter.
Yeah, we're both highly competitive. But it's like even at home, if you ever put a reality camera in a house, we're always laughing, joking, and, you know, taking digs at each other. It's like a sitcom almost. My house is like a sitcom. But it would be great coming on screen together, yeah.
I'm sure you've been offered roles.
Surprisingly, no one's offered us anything together yet.
Okay, I'm sure that would be coming your way. Or a reality show. I think that would be quite fascinating.
One-upmanship will be there for sure.
Great. Thank you so much, Chunky, for speaking to us and speaking to us so frankly and beautifully about your experiences in the industry. What's going on currently in Bollywood and some of what we see which we couldn't make sense of. Thank you very much for explaining that to us. Thank you.
The very best. It's just my view. I'm sure everyone's got their own views. And,
yeah.
And I just wish everyone a safe journey through this whole pandemic, and I hope we come out happier and stronger.
Thank you very much. See you soon.
Thank you.